What do this Apple MacBook Pro and this Hewlett-Packard 15 laptop have in common? They're both running an operating system they're not supposed to run, macOS 10.12 Sierra. Now, it's obvious that anything that isn't by Apple shouldn't run Apple's operating system, but technically, this HP laptop is more supported than the real MacBook over on the left. Apple claims Sierra requires a MacBook Pro from 2010 or newer, while mine is from 2009. We'll get to the MacBook in a few minutes, but let's look at the HP first, which as you can see, it's recognized as a Retina 13-inch late 2013 MacBook Pro. I looked up this model on MacTracker and found out it has an Intel Core i7-4558U, while this HP has an Intel Core i7-4510U, so it may not be as good, but they're close. And of course, the HP's display sucks compared to a Retina one, but remember that the price difference between those computers is humongous.
This person just sexually harassed me!
Speaking of Retina displays, I can actually emulate the Retina display on this computer thanks to an app called Switch Res X. It installs itself in the system preferences. And I think my trial expired, but I can still switch between resolutions that are not available in the regular monitor system preference. As you can see, I only get 1366 by 768 and 1280 by 720 in the regular system preferences. But in Switch Res X, I have all these choices here. Of course, the best one is 1366 by 768 at 60Hz for this particular display. But I can also choose these resolutions here, which are marked high DPI, meaning everything is twice as big. For example, 1280 by 720 at 60Hz high DPI means it's the double of 1280 by the double of 720, and everything is twice as big. So it looks like this. Stuff is only a little bit bigger, and it doesn't look great on this screen, but you can pretend you've got a Retina display MacBook in your screenshots. I can also set other non-Retina display resolutions, for example 1080p, which looks pretty blurry, but at least it works. Somehow, even if I have system integrity protection turned off, I can't set custom resolution even if I should be able to. But I don't mind because most of the time I just stick to the native resolution, which looks the best. Anyway, Sierra on this laptop is working great, just as well as El Capitan. You can see my older video about El Capitan running on this HP laptop if you click the link in the description. For the record, the description is under the title of the video on YouTube. If you're on a smartphone or tablet, tap the title to reveal it. If you're on a computer, you'll see part of the description right away, but click Show More to see all of it. This Hackintosh still has some issues, like the inability to change the brightness. Press the buttons, does nothing, and there's no options in the system preferences. It can't enter sleep mode. But other things, like Wi-Fi with my little USB Wi-Fi adapter, video with the integrated graphics and sound, all work great. So I can use Siri, for example. Oh, but I'm not connected to the internet because this thing isn't plugged in. Do you know you're not in a real Apple computer?
I can't answer that.
I said in instead of even, but that's good enough. Upgrading from El Capitan to Sierra on this laptop was almost as easy as doing it on a real supported Mac. But first I had to prepare a USB drive to install Sierra on both unsupported computers. First, from this computer I downloaded macOS Sierra from the Mac App Store. Then I used this 16GB USB flash drive, formatted with the GUID partition map, and the macOS Sierra Patch Tool by DOSDude1. This tool runs on macOS 10.7 or newer. This tool is what makes the installation possible on my unsupported MacBook Pro. I wouldn't need it if I only had to install Sierra on this HP laptop. It's a very helpful tool, as it writes the Sierra installer to your USB drive, as well as patching it for unsupported models, but it will still work on supported models. Once the installation USB drive was ready, I installed the Clover bootloader on it to make it compatible with the HP laptop. And I copied over the config.plist file and drivers, also known as kernel extensions or kexts, and I copied them to the EFI partition of the USB drive. If you don't understand, there's a guide linked in the description about preparing your macOS installer drive. After that, I was ready to test the USB drive by booting from it, which worked. So I began installing Sierra on the drive where El Capitan was, which upgraded it. And then I was done. The only thing that stopped working was the audio driver, but all I had to do was reinstall Voodoo HDA. Later, when 10.12.1 came out, I updated the Clover EFI bootloader, which updates pretty often. And just like El Capitan, the update was literally as easy to install as a real Mac. And here we are now. I know 10.12.2 just came out, but I haven't installed it yet. Most of the time on this HP laptop I use Windows 10 because it works better and I've assigned it a larger hard drive partition. But if I was stuck with macOS on this computer, I'd get by just fine. Now I'll show you what I do on my HP laptop Hackintosh. What I do before I install an official macOS update. First, I have to upgrade the Clover EFI bootloader. So we'll look up the website for it. Sometimes I have to press enter 3 times on Safari to search for something. That's ridiculous. Anyway, here it is. And here's the latest version. Okay, now it's downloading. Just to make sure, I also look up the installation thread on Tony Mac x86 forums. People who keep asking, I only use this guide to install macOS on my HP laptop. So usually it says some warning at the top saying that some Clover version has issues, but since it doesn't say anything, this version is safe to install. Of course, we get this error, but you can just right click and open. I like the name of this developer. It means penis in a few languages. Anyway, let's install it. Be sure the settings are correct. Yours may be different, but they should be pretty much the same if you're installing it on a UEFI system. While this is being installed, it will also mount the EFI partition, which is really useful because we'll have to make a change. It asks if you want to move the installer in the trash. Anyway, here's the EFI partition mounted now. It's called System on my computer, but usually it's called just EFI. And there's a folder called EFI, Clover, Driver 64 UEFI. There's supposed to be hfsplus.efi. I had it before, but every time I install an update, it deletes it for some reason. So if I go to Macintosh HD, or in this case Macintosh SSD, I renamed it that, there's a folder called EFI Backups, and just open any one of these, and there's the backup of the EFI just in case anything goes wrong, and there's hfsplus.efi. So all I have to do is copy it in that folder in the real EFI system partition. Seems like it added some new files, but maybe they won't be useful. Anyway, if you don't have hfsplus.efi in this folder, it won't recognize the macOS partition on your hard drive. This guide explains it, so you don't have to worry. Now that everything is updated and set up, before actually updating macOS, I'll reboot the computer to make sure the Clover EFI works. Okay, so I get my two options, Microsoft uefi boot, which boots up Windows 10, and macOS from Macintosh HD. It should also show up the recovery partition for macOS, but I've hidden it with the config.plist file. So we'll see if it boots up. Sometimes it hangs at the boot screen and I just have to reset the computer. But it only happens a few times. As you can see, it booted up. So if it boots up just fine with the new bootloader, we can try installing the latest macOS update. So it's looking for updates now. And there we see macOS 10.12.2. You need AUSEnabler only on the unsupported real Mac. On this computer, which is recognized as a supported Mac, the only hacks I needed to do were the Clover EFI bootloader and various files. But otherwise, it's recognized as a supported computer. So we'll try installing this now. It's gonna take a while, so I won't record the whole thing, but we'll see. Download and restart. And there you go, just like that. We now have 10.12.2 on this computer. Now let's look at the 2009 MacBook Pro. I've recorded the entire upgrade process on this computer, which you might have already seen if you're one of those awesome people known as my subscribers. Otherwise, see the link in the video description. I've had it running for a few weeks now, and it works very well. One issue I had was that File Vault, macOS's hard drive encryption tool, was enabled on El Capitan, and I had to disable it before starting the upgrade, because the macOS Sierra installer doesn't see encrypted drive for some reason. Decrypting the drive took a few hours, even on this relatively small 240GB solid-state drive. Now I've re-enabled it and it works fine, but before I upgrade to 10.12.2, I'll have to disable it again, because if this and future macOS updates re-enable the computer model check, it will no longer boot up, and I'll have to use the installer USB drive I made to patch it, and I'd be stuck because the installer doesn't see the encrypted drive. I looked up on the Mac Rumors forums and they say you can just mount your encrypted drive via the command line, but it still doesn't recognize it, as it shows up like this while it's supposed to look like this. I only enabled FileVault to test it out, and because I lacked the ability to log in before the OS started up, but I'm okay with keeping it off. Also, the iSight webcam didn't work after upgrading. Turns out uninstalling VirtualBox fixed it for some reason. I have no idea why VirtualBox conflicted with the webcam, but it works now. And everything else works just as well as El Capitan. You need to remember to download and configure the AUS Enabler app by Foxlet, or you won't get any updates, which are important for your computer's security. But that has to be done just once. And if there's anything wrong with an update and you don't have File Vault enabled, just boot back to your macOS Sierra install USB drive, which you should keep, and patch your installation again. So that's macOS 10.12 Sierra on these two computers. If you have a question, just ask in the comments. But if you want to install macOS on your unsupported computer, whether it be an old Mac or a Hackintosh, please remember to read every guide thoroughly. Back up your files just in case, and don't blame me if something goes wrong, because I'm not responsible for what you do. Thanks again. How fast is my Mac?
Your Mac has a 2.53 GHz Intel Core 2 Duo processor.
I was going to joke that you won't see this every day, but the supported 2009 white plastic cheaper MacBook also has an Intel Core 2 Duo with a slower clock speed than this one. And just for comparison, how fast is my Mac?
Your Mac has a 2.59 GHz Intel Core i7 processor.
If you click Show Details, it just opens the regular About This Mac window.